Now, a pair of stories about the Gulf Coast oil spill 1 year later. First, Hari Sreenivasan has a conversation about the battle to stop the damage last spring and summer.
In the days immediately following the deadly explosion and fire aboard the Deepwater Horizon oil rig, both government officials and BP executives initially said the oil spill was a very small one. It turned out to be anything but. More than 200 million gallons of oil leaked into the Gulf as engineers raced to plug the well. The disaster also raised many questions about deep water drilling for the future. Joel Achenbach has reported extensively on all this for The Washington Post. He is the author of a new book chronicling this, A Hole at the Bottom of the Sea. He joins us now. Welcome.
Great to be here.
All right, so let's start a little bit about kind of from today's perspective. There is still conversation and there is still progress towards more deep water drilling and exploratory drilling in the Gulf, right?
The industry wants to get back to it. They want to get back into the deep water. And it's a very contentious issue, obviously. The administration has given 10 permits for new deep water exploratory wells. And deep water is anything over 1,000 feet. Ultra deep water is anything over 5,000 feet. The Macondo well that was being drilled by the Deepwater Horizon rig was right around 5,000 feet. So it's right on the border of ultra deep water. And the question is the industry ready to do this? Is it safe to have, what have we learned from the past year? Is it safe to drill in these high temperature, high pressure, very deep water formations? The Gulf is a tricky place to drill, as anyone in the industry will tell you.
So you said earlier on in your book, actually, that even the Macondo well wasn't situated particularly great. I mean, BP had big intentions for it, but underground, it wasn't the best of all wells.
The industry will tell you that there are 40,000 offshore wells in the Gulf of Mexico. But how many are in mild deep water? The answer is a few hundred. And in fact, one of the engineers who worked on the oil spill commission made the point to me, said, you know, how many wells looked like this one that had all these features? Every well is its own challenge, not just geologically. But in the case of the Macondo well, they were trying to temporarily abandon it. And there were a lot of anomalies with this well, with the fact that they had the formation was very crumbly down there. They kept losing mud down the well. The drilling mud is a key tool for drilling, and they were losing mud like crazy. And this well was primed for a disaster, we now know. The tragic thing is that up until the very moment of the blowout, it did not appear that the people on the rig realized how close they were to a disaster.
In the book, you also chronicle this parallel arc of how the administration tried to get a handle on it, and whether they liked it or not, it was the White House's problem. There was sort of the operational challenge, and there was the political one.
Well, after Katrina, you saw what happened with President Bush never recovered from the debacle of Katrina, because it was bungled so badly by his administration. And I think the Obama White House was very, very conscious of not wanting this to become Obama's Katrina. And I was able to obtain an enormous trove of emails that showed what the administration was thinking throughout this crisis, what the scientists were doing, how they interacted with BP, how the scientists interacted with each other. Discussions about, well, can we blow up the well that was going on? Fully 2 months after the disaster began, they were still talking about
even a nuclear option at one point.
Well, they weren't talking about using nuclear. It is true that there were nuclear scientists in the middle of the team, but they were thinking of conventional explosives to make the well collapse. But very quickly, that was shot down when the 82-year-old Richard Garwin, an advisor to Steve Chu, said, no, I've got the notes of Enrico Fermi right here. I can show you. Bad idea.
So what was it like in that nerve center? There were so many different wars rooms, so to speak. You were there. You kind of describe it in a way as almost like an Apollo 13 mission to try to stop this thing.
Well, this was a lot like Apollo 13. In fact, when I set out to do the book, that was the thought in my head. I'm going to do the Apollo 13 story, which is how do these engineers in Houston solve this very difficult technical problem? Apollo 13 lasted about 4 days when they brought the spacecraft back and saved those three astronauts. This didn't end until day 87 when they finally sealed the well. And tracing their thought process, how they did it, I mean, BP made some mistakes. Also, it was more challenging than they thought it would be. They believed that they had the tools in place to handle a deep water blowout. But as they moved down the continental slope into the deep water, they were entering a different world. And the rules were all different. The chemistry is different at that depth. I mean, the pressures, the temperatures. And so when they lowered the big containment dome, it immediately filled up with methane hydrates, these ice-like crystals. When they tried the top kill, where they shot mud down the well, the well was way too powerful and just basically spit it all back out.
Finally, I guess if you had to boil it down, what's the sort of key learning from the investigation board now? We're a year past, they've made some findings.
Well, you know, this kind of thing will happen again. And as I say at the end of the book, it might not be another blowout. It might be a different kind of technological disaster. And I mentioned a possible disaster in a nuclear power plant. I wrote that before the tragic event in Japan at Fukushima. I think people need to understand we live in an engineered world, and that the technology, as marvelous as it is, there are these failure modes that lurk within it. So anyone out there who's in charge of one of these complex technologies, either as a policymaker or as an engineer, needs to say, okay, where's the failure point in this whole thing? What's the thing I'm not thinking of that's lurking within it that makes the system less robust than I thought it was?
All right. The book is called The Hole at the Bottom of the Sea. Joel Achenbach from The Washington Post, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.